Everyone, welcome to this important EDGE talk. We're going to be looking at the school for health and care radicals and the evaluation that's been undertaken by CIPD. And specifically, we're going to be looking at what has been the impact of the school over the last 2 years. So before I move on, I just want to remind everybody that you will be muted for the session, but in order for you to be involved, you can raise your hand virtually or post in the chat room. And in the chat room, we've got Jodie, we've got in the Twitter conversation, we're going to have Jodie Brown, and in the chat room, we've got Dominique Cushion, who's going to be looking after that for us today. And so we're going to be hearing from them later on in the session. So before just moving on, I just want to say that welcome to CIPD and the team there. And the CIPD were commissioned by NHSIQ last year in December to really undertake this evaluation for us. And this is an independent and real-time evaluation into the effects and impact of the school, and CIPD has a strong track record in supporting individuals and organisations in terms of their development. So before I move on, I'd just like to introduce Johnny Griffith, who's leading this evaluation. He's a research advisor working with CIPD. He has 10 years experience researching people management and organisational development, including in the NHS. And he's going to be talking about his involvement in the research, but also introducing his team. So over to you, Johnny. Look forward to hearing your presentation.
Great. Thank you very much, Janet, for your introduction. And it's great to be joining everyone today to be presenting our work, which is sort of the culmination of a year's work. So it's really nice to be here today. As Janet says, we are going to be talking about the work that we've been doing, we being the CIPD, with the NHSIQ to review the School for Health and Care Radicals and to evaluate its impact. So I work in the CIPD, I work in the research arm there, and for those of you who are not familiar with us, the CIPD is the professional body for people management and learning and development. So I'm going to be joined today, if I can get my slides. Can I get my slides up? Paul, can we get my
slides? Hi, Johnny.
Slides?
Just
Hi.
To the right of where it says. I'll tell you what, I'll take the presenter ball back for a second. I'll get you onto your presentation,
okay.
And then I'll pass it back.
Okay, I think, are my slides there now?
Yeah.
Okay, great. So, there we go. So, I'm going to be joined today by two of my colleagues from the research team, so Stella Martirana and Ksenia Zeltukova. So Stella is going to talk about the qualitative research that we've been doing, talking to people who've been taking part in the school. And Ksenia is going to talk about the survey research that we've done to measure the impact of the school more quantitatively, sort of gauge the scale of of its impact. And I'm also going to be joined by Adrian Osborne and David Ellis, two of the participants who we interviewed, and they're going to be telling their stories of how the school helped them and their work. And I'll introduce them all in a bit. Just to say as well, we will be publishing the report of our findings with NHSIQ. So that will hopefully be later this month. So what you're getting today is a sneak preview and with more detail to follow. I think it's worth just very briefly refreshing people's memory about the school or to giving a brief overview for anyone who's not familiar with it. I'm not going to go into detail on the content of the school, but I think it's important to say that it brings together much of the insight that you can find on the EDGE website in podcasts and articles. So it includes, for example, the idea that change in organizations starts from the EDGE, as it's essentially a question of liminal practices or outliers becoming more mainstream. It also covers ideas about the need for mix of bottom-up and top-down change. So we need emergent change within organizations as well as the more traditional directed change programs. And then crucially, I think, as well, it covers what makes a good change agent. So what are some of the key characteristics of people who, regardless of their seniority in the organization, make effective leaders in helping improve healthcare services? So that includes the social aspects of building momentum for change, building bridges with people, getting people on board, for example, using storytelling to make sure that the message you want to convey is landing well. And it also includes how to be resilient in the face of resistance to change, how to keep going and to try and get people on board. And those two areas are summarized in this phrase that's often used in the school of rocking the boat while staying in it. So challenging people, trying to initiate change, but at the same time, keeping on board, keeping people on board, and maintaining relationships. So five modules in the school that run from the end of January through into February this year. And this is the second year that the school ran in this sort of online format. Before we go into the thinking about the impact and the evaluation that we did, just some of the numbers that give you an idea of the level of engagement in the school. So as you can see there, over 3,000 people registered on the school this year. That's up from last year. And that translates to 1,700 logins to the live modules, nearly 5,000 views of YouTube recordings of the school, over 20,000 views of actual other materials as well. And then there's also the social engagement side of it. So, you know, nearly 8,000 tweets from nearly 2,000, or just over 1,000 people tweeting. And then the Twitter impressions is the number of people who've seen or engaged with other people's tweets. And then finally, for people who've undertaken the whole school and given a submission to become certified change agents, they can get that certificate afterwards. And currently there's about 230 of those and counting. So I think to summarize, we've got lots of engagement in the school, so clearly from one element it's been a success, but obviously the real question that we've been trying to grapple with is what's the actual impact of the school. So in order to go about this impact assessment and the review of the school, I think it's helpful to think briefly about the nature of the School for Health and Care Radicals. Essentially, it's what's called a MOOC, a massive open online course, which means that it's freely available online. It's typically integrated with social media, as the school very much is. And what does that mean in practice? Well, it means, for a start, anyone can join. So there are no criteria for whether you're an official staff member of the NHS. You could be working as a volunteer in the healthcare system in the UK. In fact, you could be not even working in healthcare, and you could be not even in the UK. And that's reflected in the number of the people who joined the school this year. We've had people from around the world, in particular people joining us from sort of Australia and in America, and also from other sectors, from healthcare. It also means that people can join a MOOC or a course like the School for Health and Care Radicals with their own particular objectives. It's not set out for people with prescriptive aims in mind. Having said that, there is obviously this core theme of the program, which is about helping people to become more effective change agents. Also, people can dip in and out of the course as they want, so that means that it's in order to gauge what success means, it needs to be relative to individuals. So we need to consider that when we're thinking about what a successful, impactful program is. It needs to be relative to how much people wanted to get involved in it, what they wanted to get out of it. And then, of course, there's the social activity. And I think that here, our hypothesis really was that the more people put into it, the more likely they're going to get out of it. So the more people built their networks and connections through social media and other channels, then it's more likely that they were going to learn. This is the theory of social learning as opposed to just consuming education. So our core focus for the evaluation was to look at individuals as change agents, as opposed to looking at, for example, impacts on the organization, because the impacts on organization could be so far flung and so divergent that it would be difficult to get a handle on that in the evaluation, whereas the theme of the change agent was so core to it that that's what we focused on. Moving on to just give you a brief overview of the methods. So the research started last November and we finished it in July. Initially, we did some background research. So we did interviews with participants from the 2014 school. We also did interviews with people within the Horizons team in NHSIQ, people who were involved in running and designing the course. And then we looked at document analysis as well. And the aim of that was all to think about what's the thinking behind the school, what does it really aim to achieve, and also what's the potential. So from that, we designed a survey. This was a pre and a post survey. So we took measurements before the school started in January, and then we took measurements 6 months later. And Ksenia is going to talk more about that later. During the school itself, we ran a Facebook forum that some of you may have also taken part in to get people's reflections on their learning during that five-week period when the school was actually happening. And then also in the summer, we conducted in-depth interviews. And here we used a technique called the critical incident technique, where you take a really deep dive into specific instances that shed light on how people worked before, how it's different from how they worked now, and consequently what they've gained as a result of taking part in the program. So the survey that we undertook was based on an impact model that we developed through the background research, and I'll show you what this impact model looks like, so brace yourself because it looks a bit complicated. I'm not going to talk it through in detail, but this is just to highlight our thinking. And if you look at the five boxes along the left-hand side, you've got the different levels of our model. So we're assuming that there are a range of different activities involved in the schools that people got involved with. We had a number of assumptions, for example, that people were self-motivated, that they would have different levels of engagement, that they would be facing different situations in their organizations. And then the key thing that we were looking at was this intermediate outcomes, where we developed a number of survey items that tested these, and then that filtered through into an outcomes level, and the thinking was that this would be feeding through into overall goals, which ultimately lead to patient outcomes, although, as I said, because of the nature, the wide-ranging nature of the work people are doing, we couldn't actually look at patient outcomes in a rigorous way. So the different level of intermediate outcomes we were able to analyze with a statistical technique called factor analysis, and we could see how they clustered. So although we had sort of 20 or so different intermediate outcomes that we were testing for, these clustered into five core themes or factors. And that's what Ksenia is going to focus on later. So I'm going to hand over to Stella Martirana now. Stella was involved in the qualitative research that we did and is a colleague of mine at CIPD. So over to you, Stella.
Hi, hello everyone. So I will share the findings of our qualitative interviews and also analysis of conversations and interactions in the online community. How do these interactions look like? This image illustrates the structure of the network. The lines are connections, for instance, post writers, co-commentators, people who liked other posts, and so on. And those are people. Can we go back to the image? Right. And community and shared purpose are the main themes, and relationships is the broader area for development where community and shared purpose are embedded. Jane Beadle, who is clinical audit facilitator at Darien Valley Hospital, said, "The school made me realize how many people there are similar to me, and that gives a sense of belonging which outweighs any isolation." And the building blocks for the development of change agents are self-awareness and empathy, or openness to other people's viewpoints. In fact, the first module, titled Change Starts With Me, explored the difference between being a change agent and being a troublemaker. And this is the one that resonated the most with people. As a result, we have other outcomes, such as foster involvement and support, inspire and motivate, encourage and support others. In particular, supporting others emerged as a radical action, something new, so in the instances in which individuals felt like they brought about change. I know that these learning achievements might seem obvious, but we need to keep in mind the context. In the context of a work culture where bureaucracy and huge workloads force individuals to focus on their day-to-day work, connecting with others and supporting them is definitely a new approach to change. And Anita, who was doing a placement as learning disability nurse at Barnsley Hospital, when we spoke with her, said, "I think when it comes to change, I listen better, which means that I will take into consideration everybody's perspective." Or Karen Jenkins, she's Scottish Patient Safety Program Mental Health Coordinator at Greater Glasgow and Clyde NHS Board, said, "I would have labeled them resistors to change, but now I think of them to try and understand their viewpoint." Then storytelling has been mentioned frequently by school participants as a tool to resonate with others and build alliances for change. We are always within the broader development area named relationship, which I discussed so far, basically, as we are talking about communicating with others. Dominic Gregson, Service Delivery Manager in the Prescription Services at NHS Business Services Authority, said, "One of the things that I learned from this school is that I tend to tell people lots of things. Instead of telling a story, instead of engaging people on where we want to go as a service." Gemma Foller, Head of Quality at Locala Partnership, a social enterprise, said, "The school has taught me how to put my argument across to different groups." So we can say that relationships are at the heart of school learning. But besides this development area, we have other three: knowledge of change methods, confidence of self-efficacy, and resilience. And they are all connected. Regarding methods and theories, Lois Russell, Head of Practice Support at West Suffolk Clinical Commissioning Group, said that it was almost supermarket trip running. The school provided a library of things that she could reference back, like a toolkit. Regarding the confidence and self-efficacy, Anita Goldschmidt, who I mentioned previously, she's a healthcare assistant, said, "It doesn't matter at what level I work. If I have the right qualities and the right intentions, I can make change happen." Many participants reported to feel more confident also because the school helped them understand that change can start from small-scale actions, which can be initiated at any organizational level. Lastly, we have resilience. Arian Osborne, and we will speak with him later, is Communication Director at the Shrewsbury and Telford Hospital NHS Trust. And he said, "It's easy to stop at the point of rejection. Some of the conversations, like the tactics about how to deal with no. Some participants specifically engaged with this concept. In other cities, this theme emerged from their stories as they proactively looked for solutions, new ideas to overcome barriers, instead of giving up as they would have done in the past." Now, I would like to mention some stories of school participants who thought about change in their organization. So, I will tell you about Jane. Jane Beadle is a clinical audit facilitator and plan coordinator at Southern Valley Hospital. She promoted information sharing and collaborative working within the surgical team. Her relationship with this team was challenging. She told us that 2 years ago, nobody would venture through the door to their meeting. And she wanted also to change their ways of working because Jane and her colleagues used to hear about the projects when the surgical team had finished them and were ready to present the results. So what did she do? What difference did the school make? Firstly, the school boosted her confidence and resilience. She started meeting the clinical team regularly and encouraged other colleagues to do so. She took the habit of meeting the chair before the meeting, discuss the content, the overall purpose of the event. And she also invited a few people to do presentations before the meeting project. She said, "There are lots and lots of years of experience in the meeting. So we try to draw on that and give everyone a chance to comment and discuss the methodology, aims, and objectives. Sometimes the team will revise what they intend to do based on the outcome of the discussion." And Jane thought about change successfully because now information sharing and collaboration, which are leading to quality improvements, are the new way of working. And now I will tell you briefly about Anita. Anita is a healthcare assistant. She was doing a placement as learning and learning disability nurse at Barnsley Hospital when we spoke with her. She applied her learning from this school to develop risk management system for adults with history of offending. In fact, 3 months ago in February, multidisciplinary team discussed the case of a vulnerable adult with history of offending that had been recently admitted to hospital. Anita realized that an assessment or safeguarding for the system, as well as clarity around legal requirements and information sharing between professionals, such as hospital staff and police officers. Obviously, this was important to ensure patient care and also patient safety. So what did she do? Anita explained that she followed what she learned from this school, such as how she needed to approach people. The school enhanced her confidence with students, and Anita developed an understanding of the importance of information sharing, storytelling techniques, and networking. The school also increased her empathic ability. And she said, "We really felt like you were part of a community, and it was great to learn from each other." So we have this social learning component. And a project is now at its final stage. In fact, she handed it over her manager, a line manager, and it's awaiting final approval.
We seem to have lost Stella a little bit there. I was going to.
Can you hear me now?
Oh yes, Stella. If you'd like to finish off.
Okay. Yeah. When did you lose me?
About 30 seconds ago, I would say. Not long.
Okay. Did you hear about Anita?
Yes, we did.
Okay, great.
Okay, so perhaps I can just come in at that point then, Stella. I mean, one of the things, thank you very much for talking that through, by the way. One of the things that struck me most about the qualitative work that we did was just how difficult the situations were that people were facing as they came into the school. I think a lot of people were facing problems that they really felt were intractable. They couldn't really see a way through. What kind of insights did you get into that from conducting these interviews and doing the analysis?
Yeah, well, many participants told us about their sense of loneliness and isolation that was resolved through the school participation, because it gave them a community, so a social group, a social identity to grasp on during tough times. And for sure, as I was explaining earlier, also the achievement of learning objectives such as empathy and self-awareness was very, very important, because they are so busy with their day-to-day work, and that sometimes they didn't have the time, or they didn't know that maybe connecting with others to build also alliances to change, and learning how to others through, for instance, the application of storytelling techniques was very, very important also to bring about change.
So, and what do you think it was about the design of the school that really made a difference in that? Because obviously, you know, the School for Health and Care Radicals is a, as I was saying before, a type of MOOC. It's particularly social learning. What do you think it is about the school that helped people in that way?
Well, for sure, first of all, it was an e-learning, so they could all participate. And then there were many platforms for discussion. There was a Facebook group that counts nearly 500 members, so many school participants registered to the group and exchanged views and supported other people in the online community. But there were also Twitch chats, so we have also Twitter, and it was plenty of opportunities for connecting with this. There were also some randomized copy trials, so they could pick our response with other participants that could that work, for instance, in other NHS branches or in other organizations, but not only in the workplace.
Yeah, yeah, great. Thanks very much, Stella. I'm going
Thank
to
you.
Be pleasure. So I'm going to be joined now by Adrian Osborne. Adrian is a communications director at Shrewsbury and Telford Hospital, and he's going to talk in particular about the use of social media in a project called Breaking the Cycle. So over to you, Adrian.
Thanks very much, Johnny. Hi, everybody. Really delighted to join you today and share my experience on School for Health and Care Radicals. I'm a board and exec team member of an acute hospital trust in the West Midlands. And I think probably one of the big messages for me from my learning is if you're a health or care radical, then look for radicals everywhere. We're here on the board, we're here as part of the executive team, and we need your help, and we can provide a lot of support as well. My experience was I got involved in the school nationally, but I found it a bit tough to fully get involved. And what really kick-started it for me was that we started our own local school within the trust, and we've actually had 24 people get involved in a school specifically within our trust and also our local partners. And it was so successful that we're relaunching it, and we're going to do another one starting at the end of this month. And it's been really good to help people develop their weak ties across the organisation and make sure that we harness our rebels, our radicals, rather than tipping off into being troublemakers. So my particular experience, some of you may be aware of a national initiative known as Breaking the Cycle. If you're not, I'll put some tweets up later with some links to the things I've mentioned today. But the idea behind Breaking the Cycle is to stimulate health and care systems to do something different, primarily to improve flow, but overall that obviously aims to reduce delays, reduce cancellations, improve patient experience. And typically it involves a week of concerted action to try and change things for the better, change care for the better. But at the heart, for me, at the heart of a successful Breaking the Cycle initiative is staff engagement. And I don't mean involvement, I mean true engagement. You've got to work with people's hearts and minds and passions, people feeling infused, empowered. And when I spoke to people elsewhere in the country about what they'd tried, to me, the things that really shone through as making it successful was when it truly had been a social movement. But what I started to sort of see locally, and my heart sank a bit, was that I was starting to see a really traditional planning process, writing a detailed project plan, felt very top down about what was going to happen in the week. And then I was asked to write a project plan and a Gantt chart for how I was going to turn it into a social movement. And I just thought, you haven't really quite grasped this, have you? It's only a social movement if it truly is. You can't just tell people to have a shared purpose. You've got to work with their passions and their motivations in order to create that as part of what you're doing. So what I feared was that we were going to be asking colleagues to undertake a week of heroic efforts. It's like, right, to make all of these changes to improve flow, it would be based on top-down prescribed actions. We'd get unsustainable returns. People would feel that they just worked really, really hard and we'd made a brief step change, and then we'd come back from that and never see those benefits lasting in any way whatsoever. The risk was, instead of breaking the cycle, we'd just be breaking the spirit. So I thought, well, how can I do something different? How can I just be part of the problem and work with others who want to be part of the solution? So the first thing I did was have 5 randomized coffee trials. So connected with people across the organization and just tested out where I was. It's like, am I just being a troublemaker? Am I getting the right end of the stick? Or are there other people with me who want to try doing this in a different way? And the short answer was yes, and that really helped us sort of inject some new ideas. So moving on from that, again, building on the tools and techniques that I'd learned, it was learning in the school, because this was all happening in parallel. I used sort of both my formal networks, but my informal networks to develop our ideas further. So my sort of core question was, am I going to be dancing alone on a hillside, or are there going to be other people dancing with me? And it was so useful having the connections from the school to sort of help keep me grounded, really. Again, I have to recognize that I'm a director of an organization, and the risk is always that sort of it becomes the leadership message rather than an engagement approach. And the school helped it feel more like a colleague asking for feedback rather than, right, I'm the director, so this is what's going to happen, and what I say goes. And it was really important to build on people's own sense of purpose rather than, again, feel like it was directed from above. So through that, it helped me realize that a lot of other people were really keen to make this feel different from what we felt it was going to turn out to be. So what we decided to do is we just launched a social media channel and used that as a way to encourage people to just share their thoughts and ideas. And really, really quickly, I mean, it might not seem enormous, but this was only a week initiative. We had well over 200 people participating, over 500 frontline members of staff sharing their selfies of why they thought it was important, what they thought they could achieve, what the ideas they wanted to bring about in the workplace were, and a lot of very, very human engagement rather than it just being words and ideas and plans and programs. It was colleagues right across the health and care system talking in real time about how they felt they could make a difference, what they wanted to change. And I think that sent out a really, really strong message to the sort of hierarchical leadership community to say, actually, we've got the passion here, we've got the ideas here, let us bring our ideas to the party rather than just do the things that you're telling us we should do. So we had hundreds of thousands of timeline impressions for it as well during the week. It was great. And I think hopefully we overcame what risked being a burden of bureaucracy to a bit of a buzz. And as an ancillary benefit, the number of people I'm now connected with in my organization through Twitter has quadrupled. So it's for me and my job, it's had a really, really lasting benefit. So that in brief was the story and the experience. Johnny, anything else you'd like me to expand on?
Yeah, thanks very much, Adrian. That's a really interesting story. Having read the case study of your summary, I know that as well as taking part in the school yourself, you were getting other people in your organization involved, and you were having face-to-face meetings, sort of School for Health and Care radical meetings, and doing Yammer activity. I don't know, for anyone not familiar with Yammer, it's a kind of in-house Facebook, you know, for your organization. So I suppose the question in my mind there, Adrian, is what wider impact did you see from the school on other people in your trust?
And it was really great to have that opportunity through our organizational ties to just be part of other people's change. One of my colleagues works in therapies, and for years she struggled to make a case for a change in a patient pathway. And so she used us as a support and challenge network. And on the one hand, it ended up actually changing her ideas for change and allowing ways for her to rethink it. And on the other hand, it developed her tactics for influencing a negotiation, not being scared of no, recognizing the parts of the story that she maybe wasn't telling to people. And that was something I found for myself as well, is there's an important part of a bit of self-awareness for me in the school, which is, I'll be honest, if people know their Myers-Briggs, I'm an INTP, which makes me an egghead. I'm the kind of person who understands what Pierre de Fermat wrote in the margins of his books, but to try and explain to people and bring them along on a change journey, I risk being really overly analytical. And for me, the school has reminded me to tell a human story, and not just tell a story, but get people involved in creating that story and telling it themselves as well. So really good insights for me.
Yeah. I'm trying to think what INTP is. I think I'm an ENTP or something. I think I have a pet theory that there's a Myers-Briggs, there's a type of person who's a bit obsessed by Myers-Briggs types.
Which is an INTP.
Oh, okay. So that's you. Okay. It all fits. So basically it kind of worked a bit like you're saying a support and challenge network. It's almost a bit like an action learning set or a kind of coaching network, isn't it?
Absolutely. And as I said, we're launching a second one later this month as well. So build on that original group of 24 and start to spread that more widely and connect more people together in a sort of really grassroots grounded way.
Yeah. And just if you were to summarise, thinking about operating in your role as a board member, what would you say you've learned most from your experience at the school?
Crikey, I think the it's easy for it might seem strange in the leadership role, but it's easy for me to be a little bit sort of cautious about making the wrong decision. So there is that big theme about going for no, but using the strength of weak ties, non-hierarchical relationships, conversations to test ideas out in a way that would give me the confidence to just say, actually, you know, it's a good idea and we're going to go with this. And I think also it was a real reminder to encourage and support my own team to focus less on doing things and focus more on enabling others as well. So it's about that change in mentality. My own background is in community development, health promotion, but that feels like sort of it's a good couple of decades ago now. And the school really reconnected me with exactly why I do this job.
Yeah, that's great. I'm just looking at the chat. There's a couple of comments here that I could pick up on. Someone saying, let us bring us our ideas via social media. It's a great idea for staff. What you've done certainly relates to previous research that we've done at CIPD, looking at the potential for using social media within organisations. I think, you know, what tends to happen is that organisations are very good at using social media to reach out to their customers, but not necessarily good about using it to harness the ideas within the organisation from employees. So I suppose, would you say that this has helped you as an organisation take you on a journey towards being a bit more socially enabled in general, not just about the Breaking the Cycle programme?
Exactly. That for me has been an enormous benefit from doing this piece of work. I mean, as I said, I'm now connected with hundreds of my colleagues through social media. Some dip their toes in and out, some are much more ever-present. But I'll be honest, trying to share an idea or develop thoughts and ideas across an organisation, I can connect far more quickly with far more people through Twitter than I can through traditional team briefs and staff meetings and all sorts of things like that, because actually I can have a very human, real-time conversation with people on our own terms, and then they're having a much more real conversation to take back to their colleagues. And it's not about hierarchies and top-down team brief. It's about this needs to be an engaging organisation that encourages conversations for change.
And you talk a bit about the weak ties. Can you just explain a bit more about what you mean by weak ties?
Well, I guess for me as a director, it's easy to see that I've got my sort of sideways relationships with my fellow directors and sort of hierarchical, vertical relationships with my team. But one thing that I think I can only do my job if I'm able to have a very equal conversation with anybody. I take it back, actually, to be honest, to my days of a smoker, which is, as a director of the trust, being in the smoking shelter at this organisation kept me more in touch with everything that was going on than any other means. And I miss it in some respects, but I don't miss being a smoker in many others. But just being able to connect with anybody in any role outside of the formal things that sometimes can tie an organisation down.
Yeah, great.
Does that make sense?
Yeah, no, thank you very much. I just looking again at the chat box here, I think we've sparked a whole flurry of debate on Myers-Briggs types, which is interesting. Jody Brown, do we have anything on the Twitter feed that you'd like to pitch in with at this point?
Hi, Johnny, can you hear me okay?
Yes, thank you.
I think Twitter's just really in awe of what Adrian's been talking about, and just hearing from somebody from the board I think is really important, because I think for a lot of people it gives them hope that things can be different, and you know there is somebody that is listening at that level. So you know, thank you to Adrian, he's made a really big impact. I think just generally we're including a few people in the Twitter chat who haven't been actually on the WebEx itself. We've got a few clinical staff who are kind of tweeting in between their clinics and sessions, and just, you know, really positive response that, you know, it's great that there's been an evaluation, it's great that we can see these outputs and impact, and, you know, let's keep it going, there's a real energy out there. So thank you to everybody that's spoken so far, really appreciate it in the Twitter world.
That's great, thanks very much for that, Jodie.
Thanks, Jenny.
And thank you, Adrian, for your time and for joining us this morning. I'm going to move now to bring in David Ellis. So David is a public governor at Birchwood, Rixton and Woolston, Warrington and Halton Hospitals, NHS Foundation Trust. Just about got my mouth around that. David, are you there?
I'm here, Johnny. Thanks. Thanks for the intro. It's actually Warrington and Halton Hospitals, and I happen to be the public governor for those three little areas that you see mentioned of Birchwood, Rixton and Woolston. So everybody may not be familiar with what a public governor is. So in a moment, I'll give a very quick sort of summary of what we do as governors. But it sort of goes from one end, from the board to the other here, because public governors are really in a voluntary role, and we're not staff. So I'm really pleased to be able to present this particular case to you. The story today is about identifying, involving and supported unpaid family carers in a hospital environment. And it's something which I am extremely passionate about. It's a very important project, really, I think, for the hospital, which can bring huge value. A quick bit of background about myself, because this is a bit of an unusual one, as I said. I'm a volunteer. I retired several years ago from a global marketing management position with the large American multinational General Electric. But since then, I've been involved with a whole series of different voluntary consultancy positions with charities. And I have my position as a public governor at Warrington and Halton Hospitals as well. So it's all voluntary work that I do, but I try to do things that can add as much value as possible. So our function as governors is to hold the Trust Board to account, and we're there really as representatives of the public. We're not operational in any way whatsoever. So those are the responsibilities that we have, and we have a responsibility for seeking views from the public and feeding back information about the trust to them. I have a special interest in this project of supporting unpaid family carers, really through my wife, who actually works for the National Charity Carers Trust. And my story today is very much about how the School for Radicals was critical in helping us to relaunch a stalled strategy, because we'd actually started on it and made some good progress, but then the thing came to a little bit of a halt. The story started about 3 years ago when I was having a chat with the director of nursing at the Trust at the time about carers, and he asked me if I would be prepared to lead a project to create a carer's strategy for the Trust. to put together some kind of an action plan which would help to implement it. So I got to work on that. We got together a multi-agency steering group, and we involved a wide range of people in that, from the trust, from the local authority, from local carers organisations, etc. So I was trying to involve as many different people and groups as we possibly could to get the best input, and also to look for best practice across the country wherever we could find it. And we actually made some visits to some other trusts to see what they were doing. As a result of all of that, we put together a detailed carers strategy and an action plan, and that was all approved by the board and became an official hospital document, etc. But then I sort of really handed it over to the trust, because one of the issues in a way is that as a governor we're not operational, so I couldn't actually do anything within the trust once it was handed over. But in some ways that was perhaps a bit of a mistake, because it really perhaps still needed the leadership for a while. I just wanted to say something about this whole question of supporting carers, because I'm really passionate about it, because it's a project that can produce lots and lots of wins, because it's a win for the patient, because if they're getting the hospital's getting input from the family carer, it means they can be looked after better, their condition can be better understood, and it can improve outcomes. It's a win for the carer because they can be put in contact with support, which is absolutely vital to helping them continue in their role and to stay well, because many carers end up quite ill because of their caring responsibilities. It's a win for staff as well, because it makes their job just that little bit easier. And finally, it's a win for the trust, because of course it can help reduce length of stay and it can reduce readmissions. So there are wins all round. It really is a no-brainer in many ways. And you know, we talk a lot about person-centered care, and if you're not involving family carers in that process, then we're really missing out. So when I handed over the project then to the trust, there were a few actions took place. We did some presentations and things, etc. But after a number of months, not much really had happened. We'd sort of generated a few pockets of best practice, but it really hadn't taken off as I would have hoped at the time. And I think partly because it wasn't approached in quite the right way. And people have so many conflicting demands in the NHS today. It's really, really tough. So it's not an easy one. So I actually have or had some significant experience of change management at General Electric. I wouldn't like to say I'm an expert, because I'm not. But the thing in General Electric was that there was always an expectation that change would take place following discussions. It just happened. You know, it was a place where change was just a constant, really. People expected it. And when things needed to be done, they were just done. So I wasn't really quite sure how to proceed. As the governor isn't operational either, I think it made it that little bit more difficult. But the answers came to me from the School for Radicals, and it was actually my wife who kindly pointed it out to me. And I then attended all the modules and really learnt a lot from it. So what did I do to change the situation? How did I approach it? Well, I needed really to reignite a sense of urgency that change was needed. So the first thing I did was to approach our Deputy Director of Nursing at the time, Alison Lynch, and she's really the kind of person who's a change agent herself. So I knew she would be quite receptive to what I had to say. And what I did was I took a story to her, a story about a carer who had been very unhappy about being excluded from discussions about the care of his mother, who had been a patient on our best practice dementia ward. I mean, we have an absolutely fantastic dementia ward, but this guy hadn't been involved in discussions about his mother, and as a result, the care that she got wasn't what it could have been. And this story really struck a chord with the Deputy Director of Nursing. It rocked the boat, really, and she really understood what I was getting across. But I went to her with some solutions as well. I went to her with what I thought needed to be done. So we put together a plan for a workshop which could help start things really moving. We used her organizational knowledge and influence to identify 18 different members of staff from different areas, different roles, who we felt could form a real alliance for change. So the alliance came together in the workshop in July, I enlisted the help of Julia Ellis of Carers Trust, who actually happens to be my wife, to help me design and deliver a workshop program. She's actually also a School for Radicals attendee. She's a fellow radical. And we used some really powerful stories to engage the attendees at that workshop and encourage ideas on not just what needed to be done, but how it would be done as well. So the content of that workshop was very much driven by the training that we had at the School for Radicals. As an example of that, we started off the workshop with a really powerful video of a carer's story who'd had some really serious problems in a hospital environment. And it really got people engaged. And we basically asked people in the workshop to put themselves into the position of that carer and say what they thought went wrong and what they would have liked to have happened if they had been that carer. And I think that engagement that we got from that was really powerful. We followed it up with another video of another story from another carer, which was a positive one, and it really confirmed to them that the points that they had brought out in their own workshop discussions. So I think it worked extremely well. And I think at the end of it, every single one of the 18 attendees at the workshop agreed that it was critical that we drive the project forwards together. We're still at an early stage of the project, but I am absolutely confident now that we have a number of change agents in the organization who are going to make sure that the whole thing happens, that the whole thing moves forward now. And if it hadn't been for the school, I don't think it would probably have happened. So thanks to the school. And Johnny, I don't know, have you any questions you'd like to ask?
Yes, thanks very much, David. And just seeing some of the comments coming in here again in the chat box again sort of reiterates just how valuable that story is. I think it's really interesting hearing you coming from a very different background from General Electric in your career. What would you say are the core lessons that you've taken away from your experience of the school that's new, that's different from the kind of change management approach that you learnt in your private sector career?
Yeah, well, I think, you know, in General Electric, they use change management processes all the time. They had a proprietary system called change acceleration process, and it's a very structured thing. I mean, I think that's probably true of a lot of the things that GE do. I mean, because they're proponents of Lean and Six Sigma and all these kind of things. They're very process-driven. But of course, the NHS is a very different animal, really, in many ways. And I think the softer elements of engaging people, the emotional engagement, are much, much more important in a way. Having said that, you know, I think that they could learn from it as well, because I think when you have people emotionally engaged with something, they're much more likely to drive the change and drive it more quickly. So I think that is a really important learning, really. The school really for me made a huge difference, because I think when the thing started to stall, I think I got a little bit disheartened in some respects, because I was using change management techniques in a way, but it was missing the emotional connection. And once I got that and attended the school, it really did change the approach that we were taking, and it really did have immediate impact and convince people of the need to change.
Great. It's interesting, isn't it? I mean, we hear so much, it's a bit of a mantra, a cliche even, that the private sector has much to show the public sector, that the public sector needs to learn from the efficiency, et cetera, of the private sector. But really, there's a great deal that the private sector organisations could learn from a lot of what goes in the public sector, I think, as well. And I think that the School for Health and Care Radicals is one of those such things.
Oh, definitely. I don't think there's any doubt about that, Johnny. And, you know, it's not that there was anything wrong with the process in GE, but by adding those extra elements, it really makes it so much more powerful. And, you know, things happen there quickly. You know, I think sometimes as an outsider to the NHS, you can think things are quite slow. There they were very quick, but I think they could have been even quicker had those sort of elements been incorporated into the change management process. So, yeah, I mean, yeah.
That's great.
So if anybody's interested, I mean, the whole aspect of care as support, I think, is a really important one in a hospital environment, and it's one that perhaps isn't quite as it hasn't been looked at as much as it could be across the country. So, I mean, if anybody wants any help or support on that front, please don't hesitate to get in contact. My Twitter handle's @David_M_Ellis, and you know, both myself and my wife from Carers Trust, I mean, have a lot of knowledge in this area of carers, so there's quite a lot we can do. She actually leads projects in primary care for Carers Trust, and she's also working with pharmacists and working with the Pharmaceutical Services Negotiating Committee to help identify carers through pharmacies. But it would be great if we could identify more carers and put them in contact with support through hospitals as well.
Thank you, David. I'm sure that would be greatly appreciated. I noticed one of the comments earlier was saying, you know, what a fantastic idea to have a public governor to stop our boards being too introspective. Perhaps you could also put out a tweet or two later with the SHCR hashtag, just so that people can connect with you.
I will indeed. I mean, I probably don't use Twitter as much as I should do, really. Oh, and incidentally, I think following on from Adrian's presentation before, I mean, one of the things that we're trying to set up at the moment is a Yammer account for all the people who are involved in this carers change management project as a means of communicating more effectively, because I think it can really work well. That
great. Thank you, David.
Thank you.
Anything else from Twitter that you're seeing there that you'd like to chip in with, Jody?
Sorry, couldn't take myself off mute there for a minute. Really echoing the discussion you've just had there, Johnny and David, people just loving the passion that's flowing from David and the way he talks about his work. And Jim Rawson, our friend over in USA, has said you change culture by changing the stories that are told, and David has just given us that example. I've come from a trust last year where I was a staff governor, and I really wish I'd had a public governor working alongside me like you, David. I think, you know, we could have done amazing things. So keep on doing that amazing work, and thank you for the offer of support. I'll feed that back to Twitter right now. Thank you.
Great.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you. I'm going to be joined now by Ksenia Josikova, who's, again, a colleague of mine at CIPD. I mean, I think it's very fitting that we've been hearing stories about the school, and the school itself highlights the value of storytelling. But we all know that we need, as well, more representative data if we're to understand the impact that within organizations, you know, people will say it's all good and well hearing individual cases, but what's the overall wider scale impact? So that's the survey research that Ksenia is going to talk us through now.
Thank you, Johnny. Hello, everyone. As Johnny said, one of our objectives of the evaluation that the CIPD has conducted for the School of Health and Care Radicals this year was to quantify the impact that the school can have on the individuals, communities, and organizations. So the way we did it was by running two quantitative surveys. One survey was run before the school started. So we sent out links to everyone who signed up to the school by that point. And what we wanted to do with that data collection is to establish some sort of a baseline. Where were people before the school? What was their level of knowledge about change? What was their confidence and ability to lead change in their organization? What we did then is 6 months after the start of the school, we run the survey again, so sending out the same exact questions plus a few measures around the process and the content of the school to the same individuals, and comparing the results of the second wave with the baseline data allowed us to see whether any change in individual outcomes has happened 6 months since the beginning of the school. In total, we managed to get 113 responses that we could match before and after the survey. It was quite crucial for us that we can get the same people responding to both ways, because in that way we would be able to see the change that happened to a particular individual. So one of the first things we were interested in was the satisfaction with the immediate experience of the school, so the process of how the school was set up, the delivery of the modules, and as well as the content of the online webinars and the materials available through the school. Overall, we got a really high level of satisfaction. We got a lot of positive comments and measures as well in terms of the experience of webinars and other aspects of the course. So 8 out of 10 respondents said that they recommended the school to others. So that's for me quite an important measure, because it's not that they intend to recommend the school, but they've actually talked about the school to their colleagues in a positive way. And 3/4 of the respondents shared learning with others in their organization. So what that tells us is not only the learning of the school is useful, it is something that is worth sharing, and it is spreading within the communities that the learners operate in. One interesting insight with regard to content and satisfaction with the experience of the school was that different types of participants found different types of value from the school experience. So, for example, we knew that those who started the school with lower levels of change leadership skills, so those who were less confident in their ability to lead change, or they didn't know as much about change leadership theory, they found that they got more out of the school content compared to some of the learners who were probably more experienced in this area. In particular, this was obvious in the comments of people who were returning to learn from the school for the second year. So potentially they didn't get as much in terms of new content, but the type of value they've gathered from the school was in terms of community and also reminding and refreshing the knowledge that they've already had. We've recommended that in the future iterations of the school, the team considers 3 specific areas that came out as part of the feedback on the school experience. One of them was the timing of the modules, and all the modules that happened at a certain time and was kind of tied to UK time zone. So we know that some of the participants found it not very convenient for them to dial into the modules at that particular time. But we also know that people who couldn't access modules live were able to listen to the recordings of the webinars, so they found that useful. Nevertheless, that's an area to consider in the future iterations of the school. Another aspect of it is access to technology. So what we've discovered is that in some organizations and even in the NHS, access to WebEx and social media is impossible from your workplace. So in the future, the school could consider different channels of interacting with participants and delivering the materials via different formats. And finally, a lot of learners told us about the value of the social aspect of the school, so ability to link with other participants via social media, in particular Twitter, but also through the online chats like the one we're using now. But that wasn't the same for everyone. What we found through the survey comments is that some people are less comfortable with engaging with social media, particularly if there is already an established community of healthcare radicals. So entering that conversation might be a bit daunting for some. I'm probably included in that group. So some of the learners requested that the school provides a bit more guidance on how to spark conversations on social media and how to share ideas and share experience with other learners in that social community. But overall, very positive experience with the school, and one of my favorite comments about it says that it didn't feel like a course really, it felt like an experience as a whole, because all of the aspects of the school added together quite nicely. So in the main section of the evaluation, what we were interested in is the change in specific individual outcomes as a result of participation in the school. So we measured those outcomes across five areas that would be familiar to you if you listen to the modules or took part in any other part, aspects of the school experience. But what we see here is the positive increase, the incremental change in all of the five areas that we've measured. But I wanted to draw your attention in particular to three of these areas. So the greatest outcome was achieved in knowledge of theory of change. So the increase here is from 4.5 out of 7 to about 5.6. So you can see compared to other outcomes, this is quite a big incremental change. And this also transpired in the comments. So what participants found useful is the theories and also the skills of leading change in their organization. The sense of purpose and motivation, so the bars on the very left, show perhaps not as much of improvement comparing the baseline data with the data 6 months after the school. But what is interesting here is the type of people that joined the school. So the high levels of sense of purpose and motivation before the school started show us that it is a particular type of learner that wants to participate in the School of Health and Care Radicals. And people do come, do join this community because they're already motivated to make a difference in their organization. And final area of change that I wanted to point out was staying in the boat, so the fourth set of bars. So here the change is very slight, and we didn't really find a considerable change in this area comparing the before and after survey data. It is possible that because of the main focus of the school on rocking the boat and radical change and engaging people with the idea of leading from the edge, the staying in the boat part is not as visible as part of the school learning as some of the other aspects of the course. So what we recommend is that in the future the school focuses more and perhaps there is some more discussion around this very important area of leading change, so not being a troublemaker but being a rebel. The same way we measured the five outcomes at the individual level, we also looked at the levels of energy before and after the school. And here we focused on three types of energy identified by NHSIQ. So that was social energy, so dealing with a sense of community, whether you feel isolated or connected to the community of radicals. Psychological energy, so feeling safe to initiate change in your organization, and also having resilience to persevere with change. And finally, spiritual energy, so everything to do with feeling, having a sense of shared values with your organization and also with the radical community. Again, we have seen a significant change in all of these three areas as a result of the school. So the pink bars reflect the before state and the purple bars are the after state. But the greatest improvement in terms of incremental change was in the area of psychological energy, so from 4.67 to 5.10 out of 7. And that is, again, change that looks at psychological energy, looks at resilience and feeling safe and feeling confident to initiate change in your organization. So this, again, may be linked to the idea of rocking the boat and sense of purpose and motivation that we talked about before. So clearly, this school has the ability to galvanize the motivation to start change and also provides a sense of feeling safe around this through engaging people in a community of like-minded individuals. So a few comments on the next slide that again demonstrate that different types of learners saw different types of value through the school experience. So for some, this was more to do with gaining self-awareness and understanding better how you as an individual lead change and engage with others in the change process. But others valued more the social aspects of the school and being able to share their own experience, but also to learn from others. It is great that the school provides this range of different experiences and the ability for learners to choose and pick the types of value that they are seeking through this course. Overall, the change that we've seen in before and after scores for the individual outcomes showed us that the main impact of the school is growing this change agent capability that we've described through knowledge about the change leadership, the skills to lead change, but more importantly, the soft aspects of it, so confidence, perseverance, resilience. And it was interesting for us to try and connect that individual level impact to any sort of organizational impacts that may happen as a result of the school. Of course, it's a bit too early for us to say that there have been considerable financial savings as a result of the school, or the quality of patient care improved significantly. And to be frank, the survey wasn't good to measure this type of impact. But the main insight that we got by trying to understand the type of organizational level change that happened as a result of the school is that the learners may have started to see their organization differently. So the first statement on this slide says, in my organization, it is acceptable to challenge the status quo. So it is possible that in the 6 months that through from the beginning of the school, the organizations that people worked in changed in that respect and became more tolerant to change leadership. But it is also likely that people see their role in an organization, their place in change that happens in their organization differently. So they are more confident to apply their change leadership skills, and they see their organizational environments as more open to change leadership. Another interesting insight here was linked to the statement, I would recommend care at my place of work to friends and family. It is interesting that the comment there on the chat also says too many people move on in the NHS, and this is exactly what we found could be the potential impact of increased sense of purpose and motivation for some of the learners. So what we did find an association in is was between the spiritual energy. So I feel like my change leadership or my motivation to change is there for a bigger purpose. I have a motivation to make a difference in my organization. And that was negatively linked to recommending care at my place of work to friends and family. So it is possible that as individuals' motivations and sense of purpose grow, they are less likely to see their place of work as something that they want to engage with. And as you say, they might move on in the organization to a different organization. So it's quite important that the staying in the boat part complements the rocking the boat so that people are effective change agents, but they are able to persevere to lead change in the same organization for a continuous period of time. So these findings just provide you some a top line of what the evaluation discovered as part of the survey process. More of this will be available in the report that will be published later this year.
Great. Thank you very much, Ksenia. Just looking back at that last slide, it is interesting, isn't it, how organizational level impacts can be difficult to interpret, because as a result of going through the school, even though we've got these pre and these post measures, people's whole perspective on those measures can change. So the intervention itself can kind of have an impact on the measurement tools that you're using. I guess that's a sort of a challenge generally in this kind of evaluation.
Yes, and ideally we would design a perfect experiment where we would have people who did take part in the school, who didn't take part in the school, and we would control for all the different types of the organization they worked in. That wasn't humanly possible, probably in the research terms, but what we could do is compare the same individuals who completed the survey at before stage with the same individuals who completed it after, so have some sort of control, but not completely.
And again, you could bring in, theoretically, you could bring in other measures as well. You could triangulate it by getting people's bosses or colleagues to rate individuals as well. But it just gets a lot messier, doesn't it?
What helps, though, is that we collected different types of data. So we have qualitative data and case studies and Facebook quotes, as well as the quantitative measures. So what those stories help us do is interpret some of the quantitative findings that we've had. So in particular, with the areas of perseverance and confidence, they are not easily captured through survey instruments, but the stories and the interviews help us understand better what exactly people experienced as a result of the school.
That's great, yeah. I mean, overall, just reflecting on the survey, the impact survey findings, what did you find most striking about them? Was there anything surprising or anything that stood out as most important as a lesson to learn?
I think it is quite surprising as a researcher to find positive change in all of the areas that we measured, and that was quite striking for me when I first looked at the data. So typically you find some areas where perhaps the impact is not happening, at least not in the short period of time. But what was evident from the before and after data is that there has been an improvement in all the areas of the school's impact, at least some improvement. And I think that's linked exactly to what you were talking about before. It's not simply that people gain skills or they're better at change leadership. They start to see themselves and their organizations differently, and as a result, they might just become more confident in how they deal with different aspects of change leadership.
Because all of these five factors that people can see now, they're all significant, even the small ones, they're all significant changes, aren't they?
Exactly.
Statistically significant.
Exactly. So we can definitely see that some change has occurred in all of these five areas, in some areas greater than in others. But yes, it is quite important that in all of these areas the school is having some sort of an impact.
It is interesting as well that some of these, which areas have had more impacts than others. And I can't help wondering whether there's some of these which are sort of naturally harder to shift than others. For example, I suppose it's easy to look in retrospect and to explain in hindsight stuff that's evident from the data that you see. But I could imagine that increases in knowledge are easier to bring about than, say, the more behavioural stuff.
Exactly, and that, I think that's very evident in the staying in the boat thing. So when we were developing the survey, it is very difficult even to express in words what staying in the boat would mean. So it's even more difficult for participants to reflect on whether any change happened in that area. And as you say, any behavioural changes would probably take time. So this is something that school would like to work on further, and perhaps the community of radicals could work on further in their group.
Yeah. So we've got, 5 minutes left? We've got a warning from Paul. Jody, any further questions or comments from Twitter that you'd like to bring in?
Hi, Johnny. Twitter's been a little bit quiet over the last few minutes, so I think that's because they're listening so intently to what's going on. So, no, there's not any questions, but just still really people talking about the aftermath of David and Adrian's talks earlier on.
Great. Okay. Well, I think in that case, we will wrap up there. If I can get back to our slides. So really, I'd just like to say thank you to all of the contributors. Thank you to the NHSIQ, the Horizons team, who it's been a real pleasure to work with. Get in touch if you have any questions about the research. Probably the Horizons team in the first instance, but we'd be very happy to join conversations. And look out for the reports, which will be hopefully coming later this month. And I'll hand back to, I think Janet, is it you're going to pick up now?
That's right. Yeah. Thank you very much, Johnny, and the team, and to Adrian and David. Really exciting talk on the school. I'd just like to point everybody to the next Rebels at Work, the Edge series, which is going to take place on the 4th of October. And Carmen Medina and Louise Kelly, who are the authors of Rebels at Work, are going to be featured on the next, on that particular Edge Talks. So really exciting, and please join us then for to hear their conversation. I'd like to say thank you to Jodie and Dominique and Carol for their support on today. So thank you to everybody, and have a good weekend. It looks like it's going to be lovely and sunny, so do enjoy. Take care.
And just to quickly let everybody know, the next Edge Talk that Janet was referring to is on the 2nd of October, not the 4th.
My apologies. Thank you, Paul.